Welcome to EMS Safety and Risk Management. In this chapter, we will introduce risk and safety principles as they impact the profession of EMS. Once completed with this module, you should be able to explain the need for effective risk management research, planning, and action in an EMS agency. You should also be able to define the terms risk management, loss control, and safety. Imagine for a minute that you have just been named the safety officer for your EMS agency. It is a brand new position, and your chief really does not know what he expects of you at this point. As your first assignment, you are asked to report on the differences between risk management and loss control. Your chief is preparing to go in front of the organization's board of directors to explain this very issue, as the board sees the two areas as the same. You are not sure where to begin, but you know that there must be a difference. With this task in mind, who can you contact to find the difference between risk management and loss control? What other sources could help you prepare to present the difference between risk management and loss control? What is one way you can present your findings to the chief? EMS as a profession has some inherent hazards. These include hostile or unknown environments, communicable diseases, violence, hazardous materials, critical incident stress, and others. There are quite a few resources available to EMS safety officers to help them minimize the risks associated with these hazards. One such resource includes accreditation agencies. There are three major standards applied to EMS agencies, including those maintained by the Commission on Accreditation of Ambulance Services, the Commission on Accreditation of Medical Transport Systems, and the Commission on Fire Accreditation International. These accreditation bodies strive to meet their own respective individual standards to achieve a level of service each agency considers to be minimally acceptable. Considering the subject matter of this presentation, it should come as no surprise that EMS provider safety is a significant concern and consideration for each of these agencies. As such, accreditation can be a useful tool to guide the safety program of an EMS agency. We'll be discussing other resources in greater depth throughout this course. There are many terms for the safety officer within an EMS organization. To make sure everyone is on the same page, we'll use the term EMS safety officer within this course. This person is responsible for the overall health, wellness, and safety of the EMS agency's personnel and should not be confused with an incident safety officer who provides safety oversight at a single incident. The scope of an incident safety officer is limited to a single response or incident, and the concerns of that safety officer encompasses the immediate potential hazards on the scene. The EMS safety officer position, on the other hand, is an organizational position responsible for ensuring the health, safety, and wellness of all personnel within an EMS organization, regardless of where those individuals are or what functions they are currently performing. While this role can include emergency scenes, we will see how the EMS safety officer's role is much broader than that, encompassing non-emergency scenes, ambulance operations, workplace safety, which includes the station, nutrition, mental health, and overall wellness of the EMS agency's providers and staff. True, safety is everyone's responsibility, but the EMS safety officer makes it his or her personal mission to reduce risks to the agency's employees whenever possible. Predominantly due to the hazards already mentioned, EMS is a very high-risk job. A 2008 report by Ohio State University indicated that almost 1 in 10 EMTs in the United States missed work at some point due to a workplace injury or illness. In comparison, the United States Bureau of Labor Statistics reports a rate of 3.9 workplace injuries and illnesses per 100 for private industry employers in general in 2008. In July of 2015, CBS reported that being an EMT was the fourth most dangerous job in America, with a fatality rate, as reported by the CDC, of 12.7 per 100,000 workers, which is twice the national average. Numbers 5 and 6 were enlisted military and firefighters, respectively. Police officers came in at number 10. If you are also a firefighter, then congratulations. CareerCast.com puts out a list of the most stressful jobs every year, and firefighter was number one in 2015, beating out enlisted military personnel, military generals, airline pilots, and even police officers, which was number five on the list. As an example of a best practice in improving safety and quality within EMS, the textbook includes information on an EMS event reporting system implemented by an EMS service in California. This system collects not only negative events or concerns, but it also captures potential errors that are recognized and prevented before they actually occurred, along with examples of outstanding care. The system is predominantly designed to address patient safety and quality of care issues, but it is easy to see how it could be adapted to also include events related to provider safety and health as well. In discussing principles of safety and risk, it is important to understand some additional terminology, such as risk management and loss control. The practice of risk management encompasses all management activities directed at the prevention, reduction, or elimination of risks to the fullest extent possible. There will always be inherent risks in providing emergency care in the field. In applying risk management principles, however, such as the evaluation of the workplace environment, job performance, and practices, along with coordinated efforts to reduce lost work hours, damage to property, and waste or theft of supplies, the EMS agency and EMS safety officer tries to prevent, reduce, or eliminate as much risk as possible. Unfortunately, despite risk management efforts, bad outcomes can still occur. When a loss occurs, such as a provider injury or a medication error, it is the responsibility of management to take immediate steps to minimize the impact of the loss. This management function is referred to as loss control. Safety is another important term that can mean many things to many people. Within this course, we will use the definition that safety means being free from risk, injury, or danger. As already mentioned, EMS is a dangerous profession, and it is the responsibility of the EMS safety officer to help reduce injuries or even deaths to the agency's personnel. While it is obviously not possible to remove all risk, injury, or danger from the profession of EMS, there are affirmative steps agencies can take to minimize the likelihood of a bad outcome, whether it be for a patient, a member of the public, or a service provider. As we delve deeper within this course, many of these techniques and practices will be shared and discussed to help the EMS safety officer in this daunting task. Based on the discussion within this chapter, there is obviously a difference between risk management and loss control. Risk management is proactive, while loss control occurs after a bad outcome has already happened. Additional information on the distinction between these two principles can be obtained from your service's insurance carrier, as well as from various pieces of informative literature. To summarize in a different way, the difference between risk management and loss control is one of pay now or pay more later. The time, money, and effort invested in risk management is often minimal compared to the time, money, and effort that must be expended in loss control activities. The saying that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure is truly applicable to the practice of EMS. The problem, however, is that human nature sometimes intervenes, and it can be easy to believe a service will never have a bad outcome event, or that, even if one occurs, it would not be that bad. It can be difficult to invest today for potential dividends later, especially when it can be difficult to quantify those dividends, especially if the agency's risk management activities are successful. As an EMS leader, it is important to understand the benefits of effective risk management, as you may find yourself in a position to rationalize or advocate for safety initiatives, especially to others who may not fully grasp the importance of risk management. As we conclude this module, you should now be able to define safety while also being able to define, compare, and contrast loss control and risk management. Hopefully, you should be able to describe your agency's risk management program. If not, you are encouraged to return to your service and find out as much about it as you can. If your organization lacks a formal risk management program, now is the time to work on implementing one. Lastly, you should be able to not only describe the current status of research in EMS regarding safety issues, but you should be proactive in performing your own research. The health, safety, and wellness of your providers, the public, and your patients depends on it.